Good afternoon, my dear students. This is my fourth class in heat transfer. Yesterday, I discussed about the derivation of three-dimensional heat conduction equation in Cartesian coordinate system, but I used the equations by considering the elemental volume dx. Dx, dy, dz, and conduction of heat flow in the x direction shown in figure in Cartesian coordinate system. I am just quickly glance what are the mistake which I done yesterday, that I am going to correct it. The consider unit area through which the heat is flowing. Which is the unit area I am talking about? The unit area is dz and dy. This is the unit area flowing, heat is flowing through that area. Once again, I'll repeat that for the, because it's very difficult to remember, understand also. So it is flowing along the x direction in a given time delta t. It means dt, small time, where dt is considered to be very small. So this is the heat conduction equation. Qx is equal to minus kx dt by dx, that is double t by dou by x. Usually, we will call it as abbreviation, the cursive writing of d is a double t by double x. It is a partial differentiation of temperature with respect to x. It means in the x direction, in time small delta t. That is a equation, that is 2.1. After passing through the other phase, how much is the heat is gone? Because you have to partially differentiate the equation when it is in the qx plus dx. It means qx plus dx means dx is considered as a small elemental length of that q on phase in the x direction, minus kx double t by double x plus double by double x minus of kx double t by double x into dx multiplied by dt. That is the amount of heat stored per unit area to be conducted in x direction. If that is how much the unit heat is stored, how much heat is stored by this equation conducting at the left space and conducted out after the right phase, how much heat is stored? If I summarize and write the elemental volume . This is del x, del z, and del y. And this is the phase I am interested. The heat is conducted like this. That is qx. And here it is coming out qx plus dx. It means heat is conducted from the left phase and heat is conducting out from the right phase. During this time of time t, how much is the heat is stored? How much heat is accumulated into the volume? That can be taken by qx minus qx plus dx. You have to make addition of these two. It means subtract the q heat conducted minus heat rejected. Then you will get the equation double by double by x minus. Minus sign is taken in order to see that the energy is already stored. There is no gradient exists, dt by dx. That I will take in the, that is the, as per the area, heat stored along x direction, that is dy, dz, so that the total is stored in a time delta t can be taken. Okay, go to the next slide. And similarly in y direction, so this is the y direction qy, and this is y direction going as qy plus dy. In z direction, this is the qz, and this is the heat going out qz plus dz. So all the three directions when the heat is flowing, because it is a three-dimensional object, how much is the heat accumulated and energy stored due to the heat flow in x and y z direction, it is given equation 2.5 and 2.6. This is how it's going to be taken. Yesterday, same thing has come. It is not uploaded, I think. 1 minute. Wait a minute. I'll upload this and then I'll take it. Again, same thing is uploaded. Just I am going to go out. Delete this fellow. It takes another 2 minutes to upload because I corrected a lot of things in that to explain you. Yeah, now this slide, I got it corrected. So instead of dy, I marked it as dz. And what is the difference I am going to get is the amount of heat stored in unit volume is going to be the volume area I have taken here. It means all the heat unit, say heat storage, is calculated in terms of per volume, that is per meter cube area. So the if the body generating heat Q dot, especially you see that there is a sign Q dot. It means hat is the dot portion. This is the Q dot is the heat generation rate per unit volume of material per unit time. Then the heat generated in the body in time delta T is given as Q dot into the volume in a time delta T. It means the usually Q dot is watt per meter cube. It means heat generation is always per meter cube. In electrical heating, whenever you take that, how much heat generated by the coil is depend on the volume of the coil. We are going to calculate the amount of heat generation. It means the coil thickness also to be considered, how much heat is generating out of that. So therefore, the total heat stored in the body will be utilized to for increasing the internal increasing the temperature of the body. See, the, how do you write the temperature of the body is getting increased? It is MCP delta T again, the amount of heat stored in the body is taken. Okay, that is equated to. heat generation and heat conducted and heat generation is equal to the heat internal energy, change in the internal energy is taken like this. Therefore, by substituting all these equations, all equation 2.4, 2.5, 2.6 and 2.7 in and 2.8 in equation 2. There are how many equations? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 equations are there. It should be substituted in the equation 2. That is, net heat conducted in x, y direction for unit time plus the heat generated internally in the volume element is equal to the increase in the internal energy in the volume element. This is the energy balance equation. By this, after substituting these quantities, considering the isotropic material, conductivity Ky, Kx, Ky, Kz is equal to K in the above equation, you will get this equation. So this equation can be further simplified and written. What is the final equation? You get dabba square T by dabba X square plus dabba square T by dabba Y square, dabba T dabba square T by dabba Z square plus Q dot by K, because K is taken from the this and divided throughout by K, you will get this Q dot by K, rho Cp by K dabba T by dabba small t, it means time t, okay, in a time t, because of simplification you will get this. See, this is the final equation that I am going to take, where alpha is called thermal diffusivity, that is thermal conductivity by thermal capacity. This unit is meter square per second. Yesterday I have written this rho Cp by K, I have written this is wrongly taken while typing, that is a correction, and two corrections I have made and I am going to give once again, because mistake is a mistake only. The diffusivity is the ratio of thermal conductivity to the thermal capacity. The definition I wrote correct, but I could not able to write the proper unit there. If the heat flow is a steady without heat generation, then there will be a controlling differential equation. That is this equation you will get, because if you are not considering the without heat generation, unsteady state, if you eliminate, you will get the steady state equation, that is called Laplace equation. And already you have studied Laplace equation mathematics during your mathematics class. And for the steady state condition with heat generation, we have uniform thermal, with very uniform thermal conductivity, then controlling differential equation become like this. There are non-uniform thermal conductivity equations also there. There we are considering only uniform thermal thermal conductivity with heat generation. Then this equation is called Poisson's equation. That is, this is the divergent gradient. Why you are using a divergent gradient del here? Is the del is the, or del you call it as, or nabla you call, is an operator used in mathematics, in particular to the vector calculus for differential operator. This is used as a differential operator, partial differential operator you call it as, and used to call this as Atlet square T, or Nebla square T, or del square T, whatever you call, that is Q dot by K is equal to 0, where del square is eliminating T in this equation, you will get the del square. In the absence of heat source, that is without heat generation, the controlling differential equation become, this is the controlling difference, with the heat source here is there, plus Q dot by K eliminated, then this equation is called diffusion equation. Diffusion means 1 by alpha is present here, that is the diffusivity factor is included in this with the variable, with the unsteady state condition. Thus, the controlling differential equation as the time tends to 0, it means here you will get not, this is in terms of same unit you get, here degree Celsius per meter square, this also degree Celsius per meter square, here also will get a degree Celsius per meter square, second is there, second degree Celsius, second per meter square will be there, hence we will take it as T tends to 0, time tends to 0, it means there is no value, this unit is equal to this unit, because homogeneity of the equation should be checked before writing any answer. So therefore, there is one extra time is there, for that can be 10 to 0, then the Laplace equation become a very linear equation that we are going to write here, called Laplace equation. If the temperature varies only in x direction for a steady state without heat generation, then the controlling differential equation in one dimensional steady state heat conduction will become this equation become only this, because y direction and z direction will be zero, only this component is left out. That I am going to mark that component. One dimension means only this. This is one dimensional equation, steady state heat conduction equation in one dimension. But in y and z direction, that is equal to zero. Dabba square t by dabba square is equal to zero is called a Laplace equation in one dimensional, only in x direction. So that can be considered. So now general. Already I covered this general three dimension using curvilinear equation, arbitrary scalar and h is vector. This is a this is the del operator used for vector calculus with the partial differential equation. And this one is yesterday taken in Cartesian coordinate and derived for cylindrical coordinate also. This already given. You can go through that once again. How to simplify and how to remember the coordinates. It's very easy to remember, and in examination they are going to ask you write the three dimensional conduction equation in cylindrical coordinate, general three dimensional equation, three dimensional equation in cylindrical coordinate as well as spherical coordinate for 5 marks. So very difficult to remember that. You can derive there and then you can give away the answer very easily. See, the one dimensional basic equation for unsteady state with heat generation is given like this. Yesterday I explained here also. Here one the mistake which was there, I could not write this in a partial differential equation. So this portion is a partial differential equation. Partially you have to differentiate with respect to x. The temperature is partially differentiated with in the direction of x. So this is very simple. The amount of heat conducted in x direction, amount of heat is conducted. Only like this I am going to take. So if all the same the whatever the figure I am showing, the previous figure, we are going to see that there is a slab with the heat generating element at the center. From the left space it is x, and small elemental area dx I have taken. If length and breadth are multiplied with thickness, it will go to be a volume. That is the heat generation rate. So this figure very well places the slab with heat generating unit at the center. See, the heat energy balance equation is the net heat conducted in x, y and z direction for unit time plus heat generated internally in volume element is equal to increase in internal energy in the volume element. Here what you have to do is xy direction is zero here, only the x direction you have to consider. Then you can write qx plus q dot into the volume of the element which I have taken, area into dx, that is the volume, the amount of heat generated. So it's equal to again mcp delta t with respect to time you have to take. So to bring pencil chalk piece, okay, this is the amount of heat conducted in the right direction. It means substituting the qx and qx plus dx value, so you will get the controlling differential equation like this, and this term is get cancelled with this term. Now we are going to write the cancel the term, and this term is get cancelled with this term. Only I left with q dot ax plus rho cp a double t by double small t into dx, and this differential equation I am going to get. After simplification, multiplying, dividing it by throughout k, you will get this equation. This is again a one dimensional unsteady state with heat generation. So now this is a unsteady state one dimensional heat conduction equation with heat generation. So this can be again simplified to this. It means this is the Laplace equation. This is the steady state one dimensional heat conduction equation without heat generation. And this steady This is the conduction equation used for calculating the temperature distribution and also heat conducted in a slab. So now coming to the, this is the previous class again, once again I explained. Coming to the present today class is one dimensional heat conduction in rectangular coordinate for a plane wall. So the, I am going to write a plane wall here. Yesterday I wrote and then stopped there. Consider a plane wall of thickness L. At x is equal to 0 and at x is equal to L. It means the total length is L. So this is the amount of heat conducted Q at time at temperature T1 and then at temperature T2, heat is going out with thermal conductivity K. So this is what they yesterday wrote a figure, and I am going to show that figure also in the next slide. See, you see that what is the controlling differential equation? D square T by dx square is equal to 0. This is steady one dimensional heat conduction equation. Okay, this has to be integrated with respect to x. This equation should be integrated with respect to x. So the integration sign I am going to take. So now if you integrate once, what you get? Dt by dx is equal to c1. First equation, you remember, this is the first equation, and that you have to remember. And again, once again you integrate this, what you get? T is equal to c1 x plus c2. That the equation shown in 2.20. So two times you integrate with respect to x, you will get this equation, that is equation 2.20. Go to the next. Using initial boundary conditions, initial boundary condition is using this equation 2.20, I mark that. Okay, see here at x is equal to 0, temperature T is equal to T1. T is equal to temperature T is equal to T1. That is one abbreviation you have to take. Here at this point, temperature T is equal to T1. So you have to substitute in this equation. That is the first boundary condition what you talk about. There are three different boundary conditions I explained. Temperature boundary condition, heat flux boundary condition, and convective boundary conditions. Now I am using only the temperature boundary conditions. Okay. Temperature boundary condition is that at x is equal to 0, T is equal to T1. Substitute in this equation what you get? T1 is equal to C1. In the place of x, you have to put 0. You will get C2. Therefore, C2 is equal to what? The C2 is equal to T1. This is what we will get. C2 is equal to T1 you get. So, this should be marked. Because C1 is 0, C2 is equal to T1. Using a second boundary condition, what is the second boundary condition? At x is equal to L, T is equal to T2. Here, x is equal to 0, T is equal to T1. By substituting, you will get the, so you substitute the same equation again used here. T2 is equal to C1, x value is L plus C2. Therefore, C2 is equal to what? But C2 is equal to T1 here. So, C2 is equal to T2 minus T1 divided by L. This is what the equation I am going to get. So, you got C1 and C2. Not C1. Yeah. C2 is T1 and C1 is equal to T2 minus T1 divided by L. You got the both the values C1 and C2. And what I do is I will substitute back into the above equation. That is, you will get the temperature distribution equation. If you substitute these two terms in the above equation, as you see from the you can see that substituting C1 and C2 in the above equation 2.20, this is the 2.20. You can substitute that value, what you get? So temperature T as it is at right, C1 is T2 minus T1 divided by L into x, x is there, plus T1. So this is called the temperature distribution equation. This is called the temperature distribution equation. Call this equation 2.21. How the temperature distribution at any value of x, you take this incremental value of x here, here, wherever you want,
Wherever distance x, you can take this is the 5 centimeter, you can take and substitute in the x is equal to 5 centimeter. By knowing the temperature at the this end and temperature at the, this end, known temperature between two ends, you can calculate the temperature of unknown temperature at the inside,
at a distance x from the left side. I think this is what you have to learn. This is called the temperature distribution equation. At any value in between that I want to calculate, using this, I can calculate the temperature in the plane wall. So therefore, x value is the only the variable. Temperature T1, T2 are known. There are two variables. Assuming x, I can calculate temperature T, because known value is temperature T1 and T2. This is called the temperature distribution equation for a thickness of slab L. Okay? So this is one equation. After that, I want to calculate the heat transfer. How much of heat transferred from left side of the face of this slab to the right side of the face? What is the equation that you have to use? To find the heat flow through this slab in x direction, consider Fourier's law of thermal conduction. Fourier's law of thermal conduction says that Qx is equal to minus Ka dT by dx. This is the heat conduction equation. Qx in the x direction is equal to minus Ka, this is proportional operator, unidirectional proportional operator, I am using K, K is the thermal conductivity into area exposed direction of flow, area exposed normal to the direction of heat flow into the temperature gradient which exists. This is the temperature gradient that we are going to mark. This is dx, this is dt, dt by dx is the temperature gradient. Already I explained that. So using this, you have to calculate the, so go to the next slide that I am going there. So dt by dx already is known, equation 1, dt by dx is equal to C1. dt by dx is equal to C1. That is equal to T2 minus T1 divided by L. It means dt is T2 minus T1, dx is L, L is given already. So this can be dx is equal to L, it means across distance. If you are using partially difference, you have to take elemental volume. I am taking a full length so that I can use it as L. Okay? By substituting these values in the above equation, so what do you get? Qx is equal to minus Ka, this is T2 minus T1 divided by L. I am going to take it here. So the, if you can also alter this minus sign, if you take inside, what do you get? Ka divided by L, this become T1 minus T2. This become T1 minus T2. Or else you can maintain same negative sign, you can also calculate, you will get a negative answer or positive answer. Depend on that, you can also decide according to the law of thermodynamics. You know that amount of energy delivered from the system is taken as negative. Imparted to the system is taken as positive. Work delivered is positive, work done on the system is negative, like that. You already have a understanding with while studying the thermodynamics. See, what is this Ka by L? Ka by L is a factor of resistance that can be written, Qx. So this can also be written as Qx is equal to T1 T2 divided by R. So this is called, see, I am going to write this lab offers a resistance for the flow of heat that can be represented with the thermal resistance. It means resistance equation. As per the electrical analogy, I am going to write this as electrical analogy. If you want a better understanding, I am going to write here over this length, and I am going to write this is the resistance offered by the wall. This is L by Ka. So L by Ka, R is equal to L by Ka, where R is equal to L divided by Ka. What is the unit for this resistance? The unit for this resistance is degree Celsius per watt, I think. Yeah. OK.
Okay, so let me substitute and calculate. Length is in meter. I'm going to check R is equal to what? Can you see here? Okay, I can see. R is equal to L by Ka written. So L is in meter, conductivity is in watts per meter Kelvin, area is in meter square. So meter get cancelled, this also get cancelled, you get watt per Kelvin. Therefore, Kelvin per watt is the answer. So that degree Celsius per watt is correct. So that is how you have to take. This is a homogeneous equation. And you know that, what is the value of Qx? What is the unit for Qx you have to write? So this is degree Celsius and resistance is, I know already, resistance is degree Celsius per watt. So degree Celsius get cancelled, you get watt is the answer. It means Q is always expressed in terms of energy. That is in terms of what you can express. So this is very simple equation derived out of one-dimensional heat conduction equation. So now coming to the next one-dimensional heat conduction equation for hollow cylinder. Consider a steady state one-dimensional heat conduction equation through a hollow cylinder of uniform thermal conductivity without heat generation. The figure shows that hollow cylinder having radii R1 and R2 and temperature T1 and T2, considering the length of the cylinder as L. So that we are going to consider. I am going to rub it off. So student need to practice only, then only able to understand. Otherwise, reading will not help you to write good answer for heat transfer, especially. Why I am telling you is that it requires a lot of practice. So now consider a hollow cylinder. So this is the length I am going to consider. And it is having a radii. This is R1 and this one is R2. Radius R1, R2 and length L. And it is having a thermal conductivity K. So the controlling differential equation for hollow cylinder is D square T by dr square. Note that instead of x I am taking r here, so dx square I will taken in the equation, but it is a dr square plus 1 by r of dt by dr. One more mistake is there, is equal to 0. This is one dimension I have taken. Again dx square has come, it is a dr square actually. This is a lot of dichro. So this can be multiplied by, first you have to multiply by R. What do you get? R into D square T by dr square plus dt by dr. This is a product function of UV, U and V product function. I can write this as d by dr of R into dt by dr is equal to 0. So now we get the integrating the above equation with respect to R. What do you get? Two times you have to integrate. Integrate first, what do you get? R into dt by dr is equal to C1. So I can write this dt by dr is equal to C1 divided by R. Is that right? And this is how the equation is getting simplified. Once again, you have to integrate this. What do you get? T is equal to C1 ln R, because 1 by R is integrated, you will get logarithmic R plus C2. Call this equation 1, and this is the temperature distribution equation. They have to find out the boundary condition for C1 and C2 by appropriate boundary conditions of temperature boundary conditions. I can write the equation of temperature distribution later. I don't think that's very clear now. And axis is here.
Okay, this all complete the geometry, and you can also note down this is hollow cylinder. Okay. Now, after getting the temperature distribution equation, so you have to use the boundary conditions. Which are the boundary conditions? Using R is equal to R1, it means radius at R is equal to R1, temperature T is equal to T1, and the second boundary condition is R is equal to R2, radii, R1, R2 are the radii, T is equal to T2. The two temperature distribution are given. Here it is T1, here it is T2. This is the boundary condition I am using. Substituting these two boundary conditions in the equation 2.23 as I shown in the slide. So, you will get two equations. Which are those two equations? Here T1 is equal to C1 ln R1 plus C2. Here T2 is equal to C1 ln R2 plus C2. So, you have to simplify this by deducting one with the other. So, what do you get? Here you get T1 minus T2, minus sign you have to multiply, here minus, here also it is minus, this will get cancelled. You will get C1 times ln1 ln R1 by R2. Shall I write like that? Because it is ln R1 minus ln R2. I can write ln R1 by R2. So, this is the temperature distribution equation with C1 is there. Now, we have to separate C1, the boundary condition, using boundary condition. So, you get T1 T2, T1 minus T2 divided by ln R1 by R2. So, this is what the C1 value means. Similarly, you have to get C2 by substituting similarly the C2 in the above equation. So, you will get this T1 is equal to T1 minus T2 ln R1 by R2 into ln of R1, because it is ln of R1 is there, plus C2. After simplifying, C2 will get T1 minus of T1 minus T2 ln R1 by R2 into ln R1. Substituting these two, C1 and C2, in the above equation 2.23, you will get a bigger equation like this. That is ln, and simplifying that, you will get a final equation as temperature distribution equation. You have to carefully, you have to simplify this equation. You will get T2 minus T1 divided by ln R1 by R2 into ln R1 logarithmic R plus T1 logarithmic R2 minus T2 logarithmic R1 divided by ln R2 by R1. So, like that you can, this is called the temperature distribution equation. What is the temperature distribution equation? Look at the notation that I used and what are the variables on that I am using. So, here R1, R2 are known to you. Radius of the cylinder R1, R2 are known to you because you are considering a known cylinder, known radii cylinder R1, R2, and a known length is there. Already given. L1 I given, R1 is given, R2 is given. Temperature also I mentioned as a boundary condition. R is equal to R1, temperature T1. R is equal to R2, temperature T2. Known boundary conditions are there, temperature. Okay. By knowing the two temperature boundary conditions, I have given the length also. But what is that left out? With any radius R at this point, I want to know the temperature. So, this equation is very useful because unknown temperature is there and also radius is there. So, you have to substitute the known radius, whatever you want to collect, calculate, you can put the R value and calculate the temperature value. Or if you know the temperature at this point, measured already, you can calculate the radius at which the temperature exists. That was temperature going to exist, that you can calculate. So, this is how it is going to be calculated. That is what is known as a temperature distribution equation for hollow cylinder. In the equation 2.24, the temperature distribution for hollow cylinder, to find the rate of heat transfer for hollow cylinder by using Fourier's thermal law of conduction, Fourier's law of thermal conduction equation.
R2, the temperature T2 is here.
So they use
Q is equal to minus Ka dT by dx at R is equal to R1, I'll write.
Because you need to specify what radius you want to calculate the heat conduction. R is equal to R1 only, is inside only, what is the heat is getting conducted, that I am going to take. R is equal to
R1. The boundary condition is specified here.
So now,
minus Ka. Yeah, that have to be maintained, minus Ka.
So now,
you already know that dT by dR is equal to C1.
The first integration I done.
C1 divided by R. So they substitute that here.
You after substituting, you'll get
C1 value is known to you already. That you can substitute. Q is equal to minus Ka dT by dx is C1 by R. You know that C1 is equal to minus Ka. C1 is T1 minus T2 divided by ln R1 by R2. 1 divided by R is there, that I have to write like this only.
So this equation I am going to get. So where
area A is equal to what? 2 pi R1L, because R is equal to R1, R is equal to R1 I have taken. 1 minute.
Okay, I'll substitute this equation in the this equation. So I'm substituting this 2 pi r1 l here in this equation. So I'm going to get here q is equal to minus k 2 pi r1 l. What is the 2 pi r1 l? The 2 pi r is the circumference into length will give the surface area. You should not take the cross sectional area. And in heat transfer, one thing I would like to draw your attention, my dear students, what area exposed normal to the direction of heat flow, that area you have to take. Remember, the 4 years law of thermal conduction says the amount of heat conducted in the direction normal to the area exposed. Look at here. This is the area exposed normal. I am putting this is the normal to the direction of area exposed. Like this. It means the heat is flows normal to the direction of area.
That is what the, which is the direction heat is flowing in this direction. In this direction means area exposed is normal. Pi D, pi R, 2 pi R, R1 into length L, along the length L.
So that area you have to take.
Multiplied by T1 minus T2 whole divided by, again it is ln R1 by R2 into 1 by R1 is there already. R1, R1 get cancelled.
R1 get cancelled. You can go to the next slide. You can see the how the simplified equation that's going to be. So here R are taken, only R I have taken. At any length I can, the R are get cancelled, you'll get 2 pi R L. And same thing you have taken. Instead of R1, you can take R only directly, you can simplify that. See, you'll get 2 pi.
Q is equal to 2 pi L, 2 pi R L, R is going to get cancelled into K divided by ln R1 by R2. And this is T1 minus T2. Right.
So T1 minus T2 I have taken. Why T2 minus T1 is there earlier and I taken T1 minus T2? No, T1 minus T2 only. Minus n is there. You can also reverse it to in order to linearize that equation. Or you can take it as R2 by R1 and then T2 minus T1 also you can make it. Because minus n is there. 2 pi RL. And this I have taken because to in order to eliminate R2 by R1 I have taken. Reverse it, minus n get cancelled. Still you want to maintain that. Okay. So this can be written as Q is equal to T1 minus T2 whole divided by R, where R is equal to the resistance. That factor can be written as ln R2 by R1 joined by 2 pi KL.
2 pi
KL is taken as resistance. This is again resistance is degree Celsius per watt. And this value is, again it is in watts given, okay. So this is how we are going to simplify the cylindrical coordinate. Hollow cylinder in one dimensional, how to calculate? By using the one dimensional heat conduction equation hollow cylinder, by considering the radii R1, R2 with the temperature at T1, T2 on the inside and outside boundary. So now come to the one dimensional heat conduction equation in hollow sphere.
Cylinder is over, now we have to take hollow sphere.
So you know that they used consider a steady state heat conduction through hollow sphere with the one dimensional heat conduction equation. Temperature or T1, T2 at radii R1, R2 respectively. The sphere having uniform thermal conductivity K without heat generation. Now the controlling differential equation for the hollow sphere is d square t by that again x square or dr square plus 2 by r dt by dr is equal to 0. This is the controlling differential equation for one dimension for hollow cylinder. So multiply the above equation by r.
It should be multiplied by r again, r square.
I'll multiply this equation r square.
This is r square d square t by dr square plus r square means what? R by 2 you get to be generated.
R by 2?
R 2r. R square means 2r you are going to get into dt by dr is equal to 0.
So this is what you are going to get. So this can be written in a differential form.
So d by dr of r square dt by dr into product function I have to write is equal to 0. So whereas hollow cylinder
is converted to a hollow sphere because there is no length sphere, and it is having,
first you have to write the axis and write the radii ri or r1, and this is r2. So temperature is t1 here, temperature t2 is at the outside, and conductivity k, all this property you have to write properly.
K is the thermal conductivity and radii. So what you have to do is differentiate differential equation, you have to integrate this equation with respect to r. So what do you get? Integral, after integration, what do you get? Dt by dr is equal to c1 by r square. This I am going to write in a simplified form. That is r square into, you will get r square dt by dr is equal to c1. So in the next step, I am going to write c1 by r square. That is what the simplified equation. Similarly, go to the next integration, one more integration with respect to r you have to do, then you get t is equal to c1 by r plus c2, where r is the distance anywhere from the center. This is r value. Anywhere from the center you have to take. So again, using boundary conditions, which are the boundary condition? At r is equal to r1, t is equal to t1. At r is equal to r2, t is equal to t2. Using these appropriate boundary conditions, that is initial boundary conditions, temperature boundary conditions, you will have to use the equation,
call this equation 1,
use equation 1 and substitute and get, calculate the constant C1 and C2 after integration. So, if I use the temperature T1, T1 is equal to C1 by R1 plus C2, because these two values are used in this equation, in equation 1. Similarly, T2 is equal to C1 by R1 plus C2. R1 is equal to R2. T2 R2. T1, R1, like that I have substituted. You have to simplify this equation. How do you simplify this? You have to add up minus or deduct it, minus and minus. What do you get? T1 minus T2, left side is equal to, so you C1 by R1 minus C2 by R2, that is C1 by R2 again. These two values, and this will get 0. So, you have to take C1 common factor, what do you get? Taking C1 common factor, what do you get? 1 by R1 minus 1 by R2 you get. So, this is T1 minus T2. This is what the equation I have got to get. So, now further you have to simplify that to get C1. So, therefore, C1 is equal to T1 minus T2, I will keep as it is, without taking LCM and other things, I will keep writing like that, R2. So, this is the C1 value. Similarly, you can find out the boundary condition for using your boundary condition. Already calculated C1, you have to calculate the constant C2 also. C2 can be calculated by using the C1 value in the any one of the equation, any one of these equation you can calculate. So, I will take C2 is equal to T1 plus of C2 by R1. C2 is equal to C1 by R1 that I am going to take here. Again, writing it takes a lot of time. I will explain by the slide itself. C2 is equal to C1 T1 by C1 by R1. Substitute the value of C1 in this. Is equal to 1 by R1, T1 minus T2, 1 by R2 minus of 1 by R1. So, substituting C1 and C2 on both equation in equation, the temperature distribution equation, this equation. T is equal to C by R, C1 by R plus C2. This is the temperature distribution equation. You can substitute in this equation. You will get a minus T1 minus T2 dot 1 by R2 minus of 1 by R1 into 1 by multiplied by 1 by R plus T1 plus of T1 minus T2 1 by R2 minus 1 by R1 multiplied by 1 by R1. So again it is get simplified. Temperature distribution equation become like this. Equation 2.24. So the temperature difference divided by the radius ratio of radius R2 and ratio of R1 multiplied by the 1 by R minus of 1 by R1, where 1 by R plays a dominant role. So, these two are the unknowns in the equation. T is the unknown and R is also unknown. So, known properties are T1 and T2 and R1 R2. So, with known value, again you have to take R1 at anywhere in the cylinder, at any point in the sphere. You can calculate the temperature, how the temperature is calculated of this equation. This is called the temperature distribution equation. For heat flow through hollow sphere can be found by using a Fourier's law of thermal conduction. For the cylinder, again one more mistake is that you can see that instead of dr I put to dx. So there is a one mistake, and you ask for the simplification. And correction also is there. Instead of R dx, you can note down that dt by dr at r is equal to r1. So, the using dt by dr is equal to c1 by r square. Already I have shown that the c1 r square. substitute that value. Area of sphere is pi r square. Surface area you have to take, not the cross sectional area. That again I repeat, area exposed normal to the direction of it flow is the surface area. Area exposed normal to the direction of it flow. If the area heat is flowing in this direction, then the exposed area is this. Okay, that you have to take pi r square. And substitute back that area into the equation here, you get pi r square get cancelled, you will get 4 pi r1 r2 t1 minus t2 divided by r2 minus r1. Again, it is simplified to t1 minus t2 divided by r, where r is the resistance, r2 minus r1 divided by 4 pi r1 r2. This is degree Celsius per watt. So, this is what the simplified equation I am going to get. Okay. So, again, it is the same. Slide is repeated. So, the coming to the next variable thermal conductivity. So, you may ask in the examination, your syllabus mentioned that you have to study the variable thermal conductivity for slabs, only slab, not for cylinder and sphere, and with heat generation for slab, not for cylinder and sphere. That is what I understood by going through the syllabus content for you. So, the variable thermal conductivity, what is that variable thermal conductivity called for? See, in any object, we assume that the conductivity is uniform. It means it never vary from one point to the other point. Now, in this case, the thermal conductivity of the material is not uniform. It is a non-uniform and it changes with respect to the temperature also. In that condition, what you have to assume? Okay. The temperature distribution in a plane wall with variable thermal conductivity can be considered by considering the steady state unidirectional heat flow through the slab of non-uniform thermal conductivity with heat generation, without heat generation, not with heat generation. Okay, the controlling differential equation can be written as d by dt k times dd by dx is equal to 0. You are partially differentiated this equation with respect to t. This can also be written as d square t by dx square k is equal to 0. That can be written like this. But where the k is the thermal conductivity. What is that k where k is equal to 1 plus of alpha t. That is k naught, we call it as, where k is a, where k is equal to k naught multiplied 1 plus alpha t, where alpha is the thermal diffusivity already you studied. Substituting this equation in this equation, this value in this equation, what do you get? D by dx or dt or return d by of dx into k naught 1 plus of alpha t into dt by dx. This is what the equation you are going to get. Only thing is what I have changed here is in Laplace equation that is equated to 0. I changed only thermal conductivity portion. Thermal variable thermal conductivity I have taken here. Instead of k, I want to write k naught plus k naught in bracket 1 plus of alpha t over 2 multiply. This is the controlling differential equation for unidirectional heat flow, that is steady unidirectional heat flow through a slab of non-uniform thermal conductivity without heat generation. So, this is a steady unidirectional heat conduction equation. I'll repeat once again, steady state unidirectional heat flow through a slab, this I am going to wind up, already it is over, through a slab, so this is what this slab, k is equal to k naught 1 plus of alpha t, and it is water condition continues to remain same, this is t1, this is t2, only conductivity is get changed, so this is the heat flow q, x, this is length l, x is equal to 0 and x is equal to L.
So temperature boundary condition also given.
Only variable thermal conductivity, K is equal to K naught 1 plus half alpha T, that you have to take. Okay. You have to integrate this equation with respect to X again.
I think time is up now. I'll continue this in the next class.